Welcome to the latest episode of Late Night with Made to Parade. So we're going to kick off tonight's show with a wee bit of a different spin. What we're going to look at is accessibility in regards to the bond scene. And I'm joined by a number of people today who have a range of accessibility needs and are involved in bonds. I'd like you to welcome to Late Night with Made to Parade, Gillian and Jensen. Great to have you on board. Joining us via Zoom is Tim Webb. And also to my left here is Philip Mackey. Philip, welcome to Late Night with Made to Parade. So, Gillian and Jensen, we're going to start with you guys first. What are Jensen's particular accessibility needs and how do they impact them day by day?
Jensen has unilateral hearing loss. Layman's terms, he's deaf in one ear. So, on a day-to-day basis, Jensen won't hear things clearly. He'll maybe only pick up fractions of conversation and sometimes nothing at all. So when he's having a conversation with somebody, he is an avid lip reader. So he likes face-to-face conversations, but in noisy environments, it's lost in translation. So that's where our signing comes in, and it's a lifeline for us.
Okay, and then how did Jensen get involved in bonds? Because you've just mentioned there about being involved in sort of loud situations, and the whole idea of being involved in bonds is loud situations. But talk us a bit about how you got involved with the bond and what's that look like for him as well.
Well, I think Jensen being in a band was inevitable because as a child I grew up around bands. And my grandfather was a member and the bandmaster for Albert Bridge accordion bands for too many years to mention, and so it was steeped in mine. And then my brother then took over the family band gauntlet and hasn't been in bands for forever. So Jensen has just been surrounded in bands, and now it's just part of the fabric of his life. It's, and to be honest, something I'll probably say over and over again, it's his happy place. He just loves it. Okay. And that's where he is.
But and what bands are you involved in at the moment?
He is just changed to Kilcluny Volunteers.
Okay, so most people have seen you beforehand, though.
Yes, in Donaghadee, yes. Flutes and drums.
Brilliant.
But we went in the transfer window to get the money.
Okay, so did you get a wee free transfer? Did you, or did the company pay a big price for you?
Didn't pay a price at all.
No, they didn't. Brilliant. And what is it you do with the band, Jensen? What is it you're known for doing?
My band pulling and all my tricks like press ups and twirling it and throwing it up.
Okay, brilliant. So you're out front with the band, with the band pulling stuff. Brilliant. How do have the band reacted to having Jensen as a member, and how do you think that impacts him personally?
With Donaghadee, because he was around them from he was in the pram, it was a matter of when Jensen would join the band rather than if, because he impatiently stood along, walking along the side, just waiting for his wee legs to go fast enough so he could keep up with the boys. And as soon as he slotted in, he was just Jensen. Yes, they know he's deaf, but it's not Jensen the deaf child. It's just Jensen. He's the same as everybody else. And for him, obviously, that has worked well because he feels confident, he feels safe, and I think that's reflected when you see him out front with the big smiles doing his flicks and his tricks and his press-ups, which have to be seen to be believed, and they come with a health warning. Yes, that's where it is, and he just beams, he just loves it. As I said before, it's his happy place, so they made him feel secure. But also with that, it's not just the band themselves. So, but that stretches out to the wider band fraternity. Even people like Philip, who come regularly to support, they have really embraced Jensen and took them to the heart. And it's, as a parent, it's been completely overwhelming and humbling to us. Their ongoing support is phenomenal, and they cheer him and they shout at him. And even with Jensen's presence on social media, without the band fraternity, it wouldn't be where it is. So I want to take this platform to say a huge thank you to everybody out there that has supported them.
Okay, we'll have a wee chat about that a wee bit later on as well. But Jensen, let's have a wee chat with you then.
Okay.
So what do you enjoy most about being in the band?
I love all the changes, and I love the 12th day. I love doing my tricks, and it makes the crowd go wild because it's so much fun making smiles on people's faces. I want to be the next Stinger Bell or Jimmy.
Oh, so you're mentioning two big giants of the bomb polling scene there. So Jimmy, who used to be with the Gertrude Star, mm-hmm. and then obviously Dinger with the Old Boys, wasn't it?
They're now just a,
yeah, so brilliant. And you've already mentioned the 12th day. Is that your favourite parade, or is there another parade that you like better?
I love the 12th day. It's my favourite.
Okay, brilliant. And what's it like with your mommy going all of the parades with you? Is it all right, or is it a bit of a drag, like, you know, having your...
It's good because she takes videos of me and all, and right, she cheers me on.
And she cheers you on as well, yeah, brilliant. Yeah. Talk to us a wee bit about some of the other videos that you do, because obviously you're not just out front with the bomb pole, you also do some videos raising awareness around sign language and things. Talk to us a wee bit about that. What's that like?
Yeah, because I'm deaf, so I want to make it as good as possible so everyone knows it, so when they step into the deaf person, they will know how to physically interact with them.
Okay, that's really good. And how's that been going down, Gillian? Because obviously I'm well aware of Jensen's Antics, which is the name of the page, isn't it?
Yes.
So how's that going down?
It's went down better than we ever could have imagined. It is, it's snowballed. It's been like a roller coaster with the BBC being involved. They picked him up, and he's been on the BBC twice, and then BBC Ability using him for the deaf awareness, and he was the only one from Northern Ireland being involved in the sign and choir. It's been absolutely phenomenal. Everything we've had back, all the feedback has been totally positive, and coming from a child, I think it gets accepted better. And why we started it was really, it started at the beginning of lockdown to teach his class a bit of sign language, and we thought a child teaching another child would be good, but it's just been embraced, and I think I need to quit my job and become a PA.
What do you think other bands could do to embrace young people with accessibility needs? Because obviously you've had a really positive experience in regards to that, and probably some people don't always have that view of bands, of them being embracing and being accepting in other instances, but you found that to be the absolute opposite, that there's maybe less acceptance outside of that.
Yep, yeah. Absolutely. We have found that the BAMP world have been really embracing. I think that stereotypical image of them couldn't be further from the truth. Once you break down and get in there yourself and see, they've been so open to Jensen. An example for that was Jensen had applied to go to play a flute in school. Now I know with the EA there's limited numbers and etc, but Jensen had to go through a test along with hearing children. He didn't stand a chance. Do you know, it wasn't going to happen. Nowhere in the band world would that happen. If he has the compassion or the passion and the commitment to do it, they're willing to give him a shot.
Appreciate that, the input there. What we're going to do is we're going to come back to you a wee bit later on, and we're going to move on now to another member of the panel as such, and we're going to have a wee chat with Tim Webb. So Tim is a wheelchair user and is joining us via Zoom today, and I just got a couple of questions for Tim there. Tim, you're also a member of a band. How did you end up getting involved in terms of the band that you're in?
The band scene from basically the day I was born, kind of thing, through my family, through the Porter and Defenders spin, basically the band that my uncle and my father and part of the family kind of formed through the help of mates as well of theirs in the past 50 odd years ago. I'm now obviously a part of Market Hill Protestant Boys from the last year or two. It's just basically through my own personal perceptory, needed a band to support them on the 13th of July to Scarva. and just basically we reached out, put the advertisement out, and just by chance, Margaret Hill Protestant Boys wanted a preceptory. So I seen that advertisement from them. I thought, right, okay, chance to reach out to those guys and see if they'll maybe be interested in taking our preceptory. And yeah, it worked out perfectly.
And what is it you actually do with Market Hill Protestant Boys, Tom?
Three, obviously the Port Island Defenders, old boys. I actually represented my late uncle in that band as well, playing the cymbals, and also do that with Market Hill Protestant Boys as well.
And how do you find that in terms of being a wheelchair user and being a cymbal player? So you have some support to help you out on parade then?
Yeah, basically my father would push me along the parade routes as I would obviously play the cymbals along the route for each tune.
And how would you describe your relationships in the band? How embracing have they been of you? Because obviously that's quite a, you know, a thing to have someone else in the band, wheelchair user and someone else coming along and pushing you around. How's that all been for you in terms of an experience?
For me, life, I've never really had any difficulties in regards making friendships, making relationships with anyone, regardless of who they are or what ability they might have. A lot of people have basically treated me as Tim and not seen the disability or the chair or anything like that. They've just seen me as the man I am.
And that's got to be really affirming in itself as well, hasn't it? You know, in terms of that people don't see that difference, that they just see a person, and that's got to be, I think, you know, a real kind of source of confidence, hasn't it?
It's a huge positivity within life in general.
Brilliant. And I know that to have your chair all done up, haven't you? You've got wee discs and all on your chair with the Bonds logo on it, don't you?
Yes. Market Hill Protestant Boys very kindly made spoke guards for me for out and on parade with their bass drum head sticker on it.
Tim, before I move on to talk to Philip here, what keeps you going back to the band week after week?
It gives me something to do, and it's the crack with the banter with the guys within the band scene. The band families throughout whatever band comes along that we interact with, you know, it doesn't have to be our own band. It could be meeting friends from other bands, such as Young Jensen there, and just forming that friendship and that relationship with those guys as well.
Brilliant. And I think that's another really important point to make, is that just that it almost, the bond scene is widening horizons as well for people with accessibility needs, is that you're not seen as separate, or you're not seen as something that we're, oh, it's great to have you on board, but you're actually an integral part of band life. And I think that that's a really important point for us to be putting across, is that not just the embracing, but what that does for each individual who has those particular needs is really important. So Tim, thanks very much. We'll come back to you again in a wee second here as well. I'm just going to move on now. I'm going to talk to Philip and have a chat with him, because you're from a slightly different perspective, Philip, here, in terms of, I know you're not a member of a band, but you spend a fair bit of time going along to parades. Yeah. How did you end up going? Because how many parades a year do you go to?
I would say it could be anywhere between 40 and 50 a year, sometimes even more than
right,
that.
Right, okay. Yeah. Well,
that's what I enjoy. I really love going out and being there, the atmosphere, the music, meeting up with people that, you know, I haven't seen for a while, and just catching up.
And how do you find that, even from being a wheelchair user and stuff? Because obviously, you know, in terms of sometimes the crowds and things that can be a parade, how do you find yourself being able to make sure that you get the most out of what you enjoy? How do you make sure that you set that night up for success for yourself, I suppose?
Yeah, well, with local parades, I know all the best spots where I've been going to them for years. so I know where I can sit in peace and quiet and get a good view of the parade. Maybe parades that I haven't been to before, I'll sort of go onto the internet and find out the route, mm-hmm. and see where the parking is and see, well, if I can sit there, maybe that'll be quiet. Or if there's a family area, I'll head to the family area.
Sure.
Because I know that it's nice and quiet there. But in general, I find that people are okay.
So, Philip, you were talking to us a wee bit there about these family areas. What are they actually? Because they've only really come into existence in the last couple of years. So talk to us a wee bit about what they are and what the experience is like in them.
Well, they're a fairly new concept, as you said. And I have been to a couple of parades recently. Well, last year, I think it was in Belfast, where they had specific areas set out for families. And I thought, yes, I'll go down there. I find that they're quieter. That's off the main thoroughfare of the parade. And you've children run about playing, that doesn't disturb anybody. You've older people. And it's a much quieter, relaxed atmosphere. So it gives you a chance to actually appreciate the bands and listen to the music.
How have you found the band scene in terms of it being embracing of you as a person?
It's been very welcoming. I haven't taken, they don't think of me as a wheelchair bound person. Mm-hmm. It's just an ordinary person.
Well, so folks, thanks very much for those insights in terms of your own experience. I just want to kind of finish this conversation off by talking about what else bands could do to make things better, either as part of membership or on parades. And let's start with Gillian and Jensen. Let's kind of think about some of your ideas in regards to how could bands make things better for either young people joining and also maybe for parade organizers to make the whole thing better for them.
I think just getting the word out there that they're open and there is no limitations and they accept everyone. Again, the stereotypical, I feel like I'm a broken record by now. But also Jensen and I were talking about this, and again, the quiet areas and the family areas, definitely for anybody. I'm coming from the deaf aspect, would be good because all the hustle and bustle when you've lost that sense is a bit too much. But also Jensen, when he feels the bass drum, if he doesn't hear it, he feels it in his stomach. And deaf people feel vibrations through their feet. So even, not even a raised platform, but even a platform that's wooden, because it doesn't vibrate through concrete. But if the wood was there, they would feel the vibrations through their feet. And that might be the idea of an access that way. I don't know whether then that would lead on to the guys with their access, I don't know, but it was something that actually Jensen had raised to me, and I thought, oh, you're right, because if we're on a wooden floor and he's not paying any attention, mum stumps her feet.
Right, okay.
So to get attention.
Because there's a lot of that at concerts and festivals and stuff. When you go to, there's an accessibility area and it's raised up out of the way and stuff like that there. Would there also potentially be any need for some signing at parades, in terms of maybe saying here's a bond, the next bond that's coming is such and such. I know people can read and stuff, but is there anything along those lines?
There's always open, the community are always open to raising awareness, and sign language is something that they're very, very proud of. So yes, and it's a lot for a lot of them, it is their first language. So it would be very much making them feel included into it. So yes, that way they would, as you say, reading, that accessibility would be available to them, obviously. But yeah, it would be just something that would make them feeling embraced, definitely. Yeah.
Tim, what about yourself then? Just coming to you, what do you think bands could do to make themselves more open to people with accessibility needs, or maybe some ideas that you have around how parades could be made more accessible as well?
For me, it's just about basically understanding the disability or the condition that each of us have, Glenn, to be honest, and just really embracing each person as they come. There's loads of the disabilities, conditions out there that do need that extra wee bit of assistance here and there.
Philip, what about you then? What are some of your thoughts in this regard in terms of how can the parade organisers be, you know, more embracing of people who are attending with accessibility needs? Just some of your thoughts.
Well, as you said earlier, the family areas are a new sort of a concept. A few parades, a few bands have tried that out. I think I'd like to see a few more of those areas, you know, a few more bands maybe taking that on and making an area for families plus disabled people like myself in wheelchairs, so that we have a better viewing point. Maybe even a raised platform, as Gillian said, a wooden platform, perhaps, which would lift us up a little touch higher so that we could see directly out onto the bands without maybe somebody stepping in front of us, because it can be quite difficult sometimes if somebody's standing, you're sort of looking around them to try and see. But I think that would be a good idea, maybe even maybe a wee parking area that we could maybe just get our wheelchairs out onto the side of the route, and I think that kind of thing would be a good idea.
So folks, thanks very much for coming in and sharing your experiences and sharing some of your own thoughts and ideas about how we could be even more embracing of people with accessibility needs within bands and within parades. I really do hope that people listen to what you have said and take it on board, and maybe we do see some of that stuff that you've suggested appearing at parades either this year and in the years to come. I think it'll be absolutely fantastic to see. But folks, I just want to say thank you very much for coming in and sharing with us on Late Night with Made to Parade. It's been absolutely brilliant. Thank you.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you. Thanks.
Folks, absolutely delighted to have a Guinness World Record holder on the show. Please join me in welcoming Bran Armstrong. Bran, welcome to Late Night with Made to Parade. Great to have you on.
Delighted to be on, Glenn. Thank you very much.
Brilliant. See, before we get into the whole idea of the World Record and stuff, Bran, why don't you tell us a wee bit about who you are and what it is that you do in your community?
Yep. So, I'm a family man, Glenn, first and foremost, but I'm also a restorative justice practitioner with South Belfast Alternatives. I've been there a lifetime, it feels like now, so about 12 years.
Okay.
I've been with Alternatives.
What is it you actually do currently with Alternatives? What's your role?
So I work on the MAX project, Mediation Advocacy Community Support, which is mainly running educational programs in schools around racial differences, acceptance of other people, acceptance for minority groups. Wee bit of sort of mediation work as well comes alongside that. And basically, as with all Alternative staff, anything that comes in through the front door, you end up working on as well.
Good. So talk to us a wee bit about this world record. It's no longer an attempt. It's you've completed it. You are a world record holder.
Well, I've completed it, Glenn. I still have to do the hard bit, which is all the paperwork.
Right,
so
okay.
I have to do about 150 logbooks, and that's just all my evidence and stuff. But a wee bit about what the record is. It's 70.3 triathlons. So I always have to explain this to people because they look at me the way you are and say, what does that mean, Brian? So it's a 1.2-mile swim, it's 56 miles in the peak, and then a half marathon, 13.1 miles. So all of mine had to be out in the open. So every element of it needed to be, swim needed to be in the sea.
Okay.
The cycle needed to be outdoor, and the run also needed to be outdoors. The record was 24 in a calendar year, which was held by a guy called Michael Mantuza, who was actually an ex-Marine.
Right.
And he had actually done it for ex-servicemen injured in conflict.
Okay, so 24,
yep.
And you've absolutely smashed it then with 50.
Yep.
Great. How did that actually pan out in terms of getting the 50 done? Was it easy or
I wouldn't say it was easy. It was a hell of a lot of dedication.
And what was probably some of the toughest aspects of getting it done? Because
for
me and my obviously physical state here, you know what I mean? Doing, even thinking about a triathlon is probably getting me out of breath. But obviously to think about planning out 50 of these considerable amount of time, because you're working family life, family man, as you said, working out all around. How did it all pan out for you?
It was difficult at times, Glenn, as well, you know. So everybody sees the 12 months of doing the 50 triathlons. There was 6 months of work went in before that. So I was doing 20 hours of training every week. But you're 100% right. I was working 35 hours to 40 hours every week. You know, so I also had the family. One of the key elements was trying to find a balance somewhere in there. So when I was coming to the planning of the 50 triathlons, I looked at the Sunday to do them because I thought, at least that frees me up on a Saturday to go and do whatever I want with the family and things like that. So we also had a coach, Brandon, who was sending me a programme every day to do.
Okay.
My first weekend in the training schedule, and he sent me an hour and a half on the bike to do a day before an event and a 7 mile run.
Right.
And I thought, well, there's my free time up with the family. But what I've done was I managed to obviously build that into my day to day.
Okay.
So you're saying about, you know, was it difficult? The very first one that I've done, which was the 2nd of January last year, I've done the swim up in Loch Ness. Down, cycled back from Port Glenone, down in the Larne. Was flying, tailwind behind me. Uh-huh. Came to Larne, straight into headwind. My speed dropped from about 25 mile an hour on the bike down to about 8 mile an hour from Larne to Carrickfergus. Talk about demoralising. At times, if I'm being honest, I felt like throwing the bike into the sea. You know, so it was so difficult. But what I didn't know was, because I had joined the Spartans, I'd been running with them for a period of time, there was at least 20 Spartans waiting on me doing the run. Now, given that there was a headwind that held me back by about an hour, these people waited on me.
Right.
So they offered me support from week one.
Good stuff.
So after people had went out of the way to support you from week one, how could you not have turned up again in week two? You know, so I've said loads of times to Lemons during the year, if it wasn't for that first week and that support that people provided me with, I probably wouldn't have turned up the second week in hindsight.
Crazy. And then it was a bit of a tight one near the end because obviously the weather kind of turned near the end of the year.
Yep.
And you just about got it in, didn't you?
Yep. So had to work all the way to New Year's Eve, but I'll even take it back forever and that again. And I think it was June time, I touched for COVID as well. You know, so there was a week out there. I had booked the lads' holiday a few years ago that was postponed and put back. So there was a lads' holiday through in there as which I didn't do a triathlon on night. I wasn't big into drinking when I was on the holiday. I still trained and done me some warm weather training when I was there. We also had a family holiday, so I put myself back all these weeks. October and November, I realised, oh God, this is on top of me. There's no way am I going to get 50 done. So I kept working really, really hard. And alternatives were really flexible with me as well and really supportive of me that way. And they were able to say, today's going to be a good day away. You can do a triathlon.
Sure.
So they were brilliant with me. And I managed to get caught up. I came to December and a big freeze kicked in. For about 10 days, I couldn't do anything. So you're 100% right. The last week, I had 3 triathlons to do after Christmas. Again, big push. So last week, I think I covered about 400 miles all in by time training and doing the triathlons themselves. But support. So Pete Bailey works in Shankill Alternatives. Pete came and done the cycle with me. So again, Pete was sacrificing his own time from his own family and around Christmas to come out and support me to make sure that I got these triathlons done. So again, all I had to do was turn up and be supported by people.
Yeah.
I knew I was capable of getting the triathlon done. The fact that our people were willing to sacrifice themselves to support me was amazing.
Yeah. But it wasn't just about the achievement, though,
was
it? It wasn't just about, let's go and break a world record, as good as that is.
Yeah.
What was the other motivation behind this?
Really, right, Glenn, when I officially announced this to the alternative staff last year at the practitioners forum that I was going to do, one of the questions was asked, was, why would you want to do 50? The world record doesn't actually mean a whole lot to me, to be quite honest. What it means is actually the fact that somebody can go and do something so big. So part of it was, again, that background of people telling people in working class communities that they can achieve things. Part of me being a youth worker and a restorative practitioner, I'm in a very privileged position. So part of it was that I wanted to go in and help motivate people, go in and have conversations with young people. So I've engaged 4,500 young people in schools and youth clubs and community groups, actually doing talks around believe in yourself, but surround yourself by supportive people who are going to encourage you, and you would be surprised at the outcome that you can get.
And there was the whole idea around sort of promoting positive mental health as well was part of the whole thing.
So when I was looking at, you know, yes, I'm going to attempt to break a world record here, part of me thought I might as well try and raise money for charity because I'm never going to try and break a world record again in my life. Well, from the outside, it wasn't a mate. I'm not saying, I wouldn't say never. What was that connection between the physical and the mental health? People say to me all the time, you're not tired, you're not sore. I have never felt physically and mentally better in my life, and I've never been as productive.
Cool. And what about the financial side of it? How much did you end up raising, if you don't mind sharing?
I think, Glenn, so there's a Just Giving page that I think there's about £3,700 on, and I think there's about £6,000 in total on checks that don't show in the Just Giving.
Right, okay.
So again, the checks are coming from community groups such as the South Belfast Youth League, which I was going in and doing talks with, you know, okay. So you were being supported that way. Schools that had done the talks in raised money as well, and then they donated through a check. You okay. know, so again, the people who you were going in and talking to, the fact that they were donating money meant that you were having some sort of impact on them. Right.
And where's that going to?
That's actually going to develop Alternatives Restorative Justice Wellbeing Programme.
Okay.
That's currently being run out of Shankill Alternatives, which sees you receiving therapy for your mental health, but also working then with PTs around the physical side. So what we're trying to do is support people to encourage lifestyle changes. Mm-hmm. You can work with the mental health, but unless you're supporting and encouraging them physical changes in people's lives, and even the type of life that they live,
yeah.
and the environment and the people that they're surrounded by, you know, it's very easy yeah. for people to fall back into the same traps of
exactly.
being sent back to the same people.
Yeah. So to provide that wraparound service, it's yeah. an extension of the type of wraparound yeah. service that Alternatives provides normally yeah. anyway. But what's next then? Because obviously you've just broke a world record.
Yep.
Great. What are you doing next?
So what I have booked then, because of the support that I've got from the Spartans, a guy called Graham Beatty would have run with me. I think Graham Beatty and Brian Gap run there enough every single week with me. I
right,
think
okay.
they've done about 40 of the triathlons with me.
Right. Wow.
They're ultra runners.
Right.
So they've sucked me into doing a thing called Dealing with 48. So you can do a 12-hour, 24-hour, 36-hours, or 48-hour run in OMA. I went for the late one, which is a 12-hour run
okay.
that we're hoping to cover 50 miles in.
Right.
And that'll be my stepping stone. Then there's an event in Victoria Park, which is a 24-hour run, which I'm hoping to do in June. And then I'm hopefully going to do a thing called Last Man Standing, which is a 4.2-mile run on the hour, every hour, for as long as you can possibly go.
But Brian, I just want to say, well done.
Thank you.
Absolutely amazing to have watched this go from a concept
yep.
to you actually completing it. And I'm sure you're proud of yourself, and I know that the whole Alternatives family are
yep.
extremely proud of what you've achieved, mate. So well done, and
thank
congratulations
you.
On a Guinness World Record.
Thank you very much, Glenn.
One of the things that we're interested in promoting on Late Night with Mia Dupree, you'll see we have three things that we're focusing in on, which is positive culture, positive history for positive future. And we spent some time recently down in Ballyclare at the War Years Remembered Museum. And this is a museum that has an amazing amount of artifacts relating to the war and Northern Ireland's history. And unfortunately, it is under some serious strain financially, and it could potentially go out of existence, and it would be an absolute shame to see that happen. So folks, what we're going to do now is we are going to show you a wee clip of our visit to the War Years Remembered Museum, and there will be details on how you can help out at the end of this clip. Alrighty folks, welcome to a special for Late Night with Mia Dupree. We're here at probably one of the hidden gems in terms of culture and history in Northern Ireland. We're in North Arba. We're at the War Years Remembered Museum in Ballyclare. One of the reasons why we're here is because it's got one of the largest collections of war memorabilia in the whole of probably the UK, I'd say, in regards to the amount of pieces that we have here. So what we're going to do now is we're going to have a chat with the curator of the museum, David, and he's going to tell us a wee bit about how he came into possession of all of this amazing memorabilia. And he's here at a very poignant place in terms of stuff that relates to Blair Bain. David, absolutely fantastic to have you on with us on Mia Dupree. tell us a wee bit about the museum. Obviously, the rains, it's rains licensed down here and stuff, yeah. But tell us a wee bit about the museum itself. And how did you end up getting involved in this?
Well, it all started off, thanks very much for coming along, by the way. Basically, I was 8 years of age. I was given Grandad's chocolate tin and his belt, mm-hmm. and he'd served in the First World War. And I got a tad out of control, didn't stop playing with Action Man, I got 6 foot tall.
Right, okay.
I got Cindy and Barbie to play with as well. But what I was annoyed about was we didn't have a war museum in this country. Uh-huh. And at the end of the day, very, very important story is the history of the Irish soldier. We've been fighting for English for thousands of years, either fighting for them or fighting against them.
Sure.
But the Irish soldier has been always at the main battle, in the mid, and especially the Battle of Waterloo.
Uh-huh.
The 27th and the Skillings held the line and helped defeat Napoleon. You know, right through to obviously the greatest two impacts of the 20th century, mm-hmm. was the First World War and the Second World War.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And that brings a lot of our local heroes into it. And as you said, we were kindly gifted by the family, the whole Blair Main estate, from his uniform to his medals to his certificates. And his whole battle trunk is full of paperwork. It's going to probably take us about 10 years to full research,
okay.
on every single letter that we have, because he was a prolific writer. Mm-hmm. He wasn't just six times cap for Ireland in rugby. He played for the British and Irish Lions, South African tour 1938. He studied as a solicitor, Queen's University boxing champion as well. The man was a Freemason.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of history with Blair, sure. to come out yet,
yeah.
As well as being an Antarctic surveyor in 1945. He went to the Falkland Island Dependency Survey, which a lot of people don't know about, and he spent time down there at Port Lockroy in Dissension Island, surveying the Antarctic, putting a British stamp on it, uh-huh. And flying the Union flag. So it was a very, very important role that he had, but sadly, due to the injuries from parachuting, his back went on him and he ended up going to Port Stanley in the Falklands,
right.
to recover, and then came home. Sorry, excuse me.
Bring that back in.
But why he's one of the most important guys is he's one of the highest soldiers from the Second World War, highly decorated. Sadly, the VC eluded him, and he had been recommended for it. And it was struck out and downgraded to the third bar to the DSO.
Right, okay.
The second highest military honour that a soldier can get is the DSO, the Distinguished Service Order. That's the first medal, and you'll notice three bars on it.
Right.
So it's quite an achievement for the guy to actually be awarded all those medals, as well as he was the co-founder of the SES, and all of a sudden, it's a massive story on the BBC.
That's right, with the rogue heroes.
The rogue heroes. Doesn't do him justice because he's just a drunk Irishman. It doesn't really portray him in a good light because the man was an educated guy. He went to Regent House, played for the 15s, and also, you know, he was a thinker. He was into poetry, you know, so it hasn't... What it's done is, the good side of it is, it's let a lot of people know who he is.
Yeah.
But it's our job now, it's more important now that this carries on and educating people on who Blair Main really was.
Sure. Well, one of the things that I wanted to get across was, obviously, David, this is a small part of what you have, because,
yeah.
yes, Blair Main's a large character in terms,
yeah,
of history,
yep.
but it's a small part of what you have here,
yeah.
at the museum. How many pieces do you reckon you have here?
There's hundreds of thousands of items here. There's no doubt about it. From personal letters home from the First World War, uh-huh. Love letters, personal letters, medals, photographs, uniforms, weaponry, vehicles. And we don't just have, obviously, military history, we have social history here as well. We also cover the home front, which is the Second World War, women in the factories, the men and women that worked in the fields, doing the farming, the munitions workers, but also the pre-runner to the First World War, 1912, the Home Rule Crisis.
Sure.
And we had a massive collection on display as you came through the door to the Ulster Volunteer Force, the Irish Volunteers, because as Grandad always said, there was no orange and green in the trenches, just red blood.
Yep. Talk to us a wee bit about your current situation, what's happening, and maybe towards the end of that, tell people what they might be able to do to try and, yeah. maybe help.
Basically, the situation sort of hit, as you know, with everybody COVID, and we relied, we were quite successful up to COVID, we were doing quite well, and we had a full year booked, we were booked out, in fact. We even had people coming from America to see this.
Sure.
They've even written reviews on TripAdvisor, the best museum, more impressive than Titanic.
Uh-huh.
They were getting to understand who we were as an Irish nation and the story of Ulster and the men that, that fought in the wars through the collection. And we battled through COVID. However, we didn't close up through COVID.
Sure, uh-huh.
We stayed open, not open to the public, but we carried on with research. We did the Blur Main story on the Antarctic exhibition. We got a story printed through Jeff Cooper, the UK Antarctic Historical Trust, the British Antarctic Society.
Uh-huh.
We did a story with Lord Ashcroft, the bravest man not to be awarded the Victoria Cross. And we also did a story with the British and Irish Lions.
Uh-huh.
All free gratis, by the way, free of charge.
Sure.
We've done that during COVID. And we did 8 episodes for NVTV in Belfast. Right,
okay. What is the current state of play then?
The current state of play now is we're packing up. We've got to evacuate the building as quick as possible.
Right.
And we need to find a new home for it.
Okay, and that's obviously got to be an expansive issue because the amount of stuff that's here, trying to find storage or at least even trying to find an alternate location.
That's it, even putting in the storage is costing us money.
Yeah.
Through the Just Given appeal that we run 2 years ago, we started, well, it's nearly free now, but we got raised over £34,000 through the generosity of the public.
Uh-huh.
That's kept us running up to now, paid for insurances, running costs, etc. We're now obviously in this, if we can't find a building where we're getting people somebody rates relief or a building being gifted to us, which we also asked our MLAs and MPs to see if there was anything that the government had that could house the collection, which sadly we got no reply on. But the way out of it is, so we're never in this predicament again, is to find our own building. And the trustees and directors have met with other stakeholders and people that really do care about what's here and the importance of it. And sadly, with poor health over the last year, I've hardly been here myself. They've met with various bodies and people who have a genuine interest. And they've all come up with the same scenario. We need to raise the money to buy a building or build a building. So if somebody has the means of a plot of ground or a building that they can give the charity, because at the end of the day, it is Warriors Remember the charity as well as a museum, because it's done a lot of work with veterans over the years as well, special needs kids, as I say, from the we've actually helped with the Marie Curie Make-A-Wish Foundation. A lot of the military charities from Help of Heroes, ABF, the Royal British Legion over the years. So if we can get that help, but even down to the most important thing at the minute, the new Just Given page that's been put up by one of our trustees, if people can donate directly to that.
Well, folks, we've just had a brief look around here, and I mean, you've heard David speaking there. I don't think I've heard as much history in regards to those individual stories from people as I've heard from just listening to you, not just in the conversation we've had here, but prior to us even starting filming. Folks, if you've been interested in the war, in the First World War, the Second World War at all, do us all a big favour. Get in touch through the Facebook page. Go and visit the Just Given page and come and support the War Years Remembered Museum. It would be an absolute shame to lose a collection like this. I mean, I've been absolutely blown away. The range of uniforms, artifacts, even one of the things in the houses here, the very train ticket that somebody was using to go off to the wars in the pocket of their uniform and stuff. Folks, if you don't want to lose this, you know, collection, get on to your own MLA, your councillors, whatever. There's bound to be people out there who would be able to help and try and preserve this amazing collection of artifacts in relation to the war. I know I've been blown away by being here, and I just want to say thanks, David, for
having us down and
being able to share something with us. And if we can do anything to help you, be it the parade, we'll be more than happy just to keep promoting and sharing stuff as well. So, folks, we're going to move on now, and we're going to have a wee bit of a chat with Andrew Lynch, who is involved with the Northwest Cultural Partnership, talking a bit about the work that they do in schools, teaching young people how to play the B-flat flute. But before we do that, let's have a wee performance from some of the young people involved. That was great, lads. Thanks very much for that. Andre, welcome along to Late Night with Me at the Parade. Absolutely brilliant to have you along.
Thanks for having me, Glenn.
Did all, would you mind maybe just introduce yourself then, Andre, and tell us a wee bit about what it is that you do?
Yep, so my name's Andrew Lynch. I am a B-flat flute tutor with the Northwest Cultural Partnership. So I travel around schools within the Northwest area, or Derry and Strabane Council area, and teach young people flute. So I am currently teaching in 5 schools. And we teach them how to play the B-flat flute, but also the music theory. So our focus is on the music theory, and we use the flute as a practical way of learning the theory. So this started a couple of years back, when one of the schools actually got in contact with us to say that 25 of the pupils had got applied for education tuition, and only 5 of them had got through. So they all were 20, they were sitting with no sort of music tuition. So they asked us, is there anything we could do? And we said, well, we'll come in and teach. And it all started from there. And I suppose my background was I started the band, the William King Flute Band, so I'm a member of there. And I started in there maybe 10, 15 years ago. Mm-hmm. And I just kept going. And then they needed somebody to teach the flute. So I was there every week. So they asked me, could I teach the flute? And it built from there. Then the job with the sort of band's foreign partnership came up. So I decided to go for it then as well.
What was the initial response like? Because obviously with, you know, I was going to ask you about the motivation behind that. Obviously there was a need in the school that approached you. How did they respond to initially to you going in and teaching the B-flat flute? Because it doesn't, bands and flute bands don't always have that whole idea, or the best reputation in some people's minds, but how were they with you going in?
I think the teacher that have sort of had us in at the start knew the band and background, but as I found out later, the more I got in, the teachers were sort of less, I wouldn't say less keen, but they were sort of doubtful of what we were actually coming in to do. I think a lot of them had seen the media and the press and the reputation, so they thought we were coming in just to teach, you know, simple tunes and stuff. They didn't see the actual skills that the pupils could learn. So I think at the start we had issues, especially to get more skills, I think. But once we got in that first school and they worked there for a year or two, we were able to approach other schools, and obviously word got about. So it did get easier. But I think the initial thing, and especially I think with the B-flat flute, there's still a lot of perceptions out there that maybe with bagpipes and other instruments, it's not there. But the B-flat flute, there's still perceptions there, and teachers are still sort of doubtful of it. But they see the work now that they get, and there's young pupils now standing up in front of schools playing who can't even stand up in front of their class to read a story. So they see the benefit of it, but there was.
So how did you overcome that? Well, obviously you were saying there's maybe some apprehension there just due to people's thoughts and perceptions. What did you actively do to try and overcome that, to help them maybe come around and see the value of what it is that you were doing?
Well, just by going in and teaching, you know, we try to stay away in the school stuff from the bands, and it's all about music, you know, and them learning. But it's also about the skills that the flute and playing in a group can have, about the confidence, about the teamwork, all that sort of stuff. And then we sort of threw the music in then. And we also try to teach the background of, we try to teach more music as well. So like composers and different instruments and things. So we're trying to make it a full package. So it is very, half of it is about flute, but the other half is about trying to develop young people going forward. And also that the schools can see the schools see the benefit of it then. We have players playing in front of people, and to be fair, some of the flute players that we have wouldn't be at the top of their class, but suddenly now they're up playing and do it. So they can see the benefit of maybe not the troublesome, but sometimes the difficult children. No, it's a way for them to engage. And because they see bands at home, they see bands on the street, they have the link with it anyway. A lot of times when you go in and say, they ask you a member of a band, and then they say that my granny is, my granda, my uncle. So they know about bands and that they've grown up with it as well.
And how has working in the schools enhanced the kind of the work of the Northwest Cultural Partnership? What has it done for you guys?
Well, it's tied it all together, because I think we go in and teach pupils, but you got to look at the wider picture. You know, we're getting in touch them with the parents. We're getting in touch with the grannies, grandas, aunts, uncles. So it's tying it all in. You know, we get the young person, we send the young person home sometimes with a flute, or not even a flute, just with the skills. And they're going home and saying to their dad or parent, can I have borrow your flute? So we're getting a wider thing, because it's also building family connections. We're not only building connections in bands and music, but we're also helping the families to bond as well. So it's a much wider thing that we can do, that we can bring into the partnership and help develop. Because some people I'm teaching today might grow up to be an ex-community leader, might grow up to be an ex-leader of the partnership. So we see it for building for the future.
Brilliant. No, I think that's it's so important to have those relationships and to connect outside the school, the wider community. And for, I suppose in this day and age, whenever sometimes relationships right across the board aren't always, you know, great, but giving young people something that helps them connect with their parents, help them connect with the wider community is a great thing to have. So you started off with one school, and you said they're about trying to get more schools involved. How has that, you know, program developed in the schools in the area that you're working in?
Well, I think for the last 4 or 5 years, it's gradually built up. You know, so when we're now at full capacity, you know, I'm teaching 200 pupils in 6 schools, but really there is other schools there that sort of we could go in and want us in. So we're actually having now to build sort of like a waiting list that want schools, because they see the benefit, and these teachers, they talk to each other and they know what's involved, and they know what the schools are getting out of. But parents as well, you know, some of the parents will know parents from other schools and stuff. So we've gradually now, and we're actually expanded this year, or last year, we expanded down to Lumvaddy. So I'm in a school in Lumvaddy as well. So we see it as a wider area. And also the two wee boys that play there from Lisneil, that's us sort of expanding it to the next level, because I teach from P5, P6 and P7 in most of the schools. So then we get them for another 2 or 3 years in the Lisneil College as well. So we're having them for like 6 years, so we can develop them right through and help promote and get them not only good players, but also the social side and their skills like that as well through music.
Apart from obviously learning how to play an instrument, what other, and the whole idea of the social skills and stuff, there's accreditation attached to this as well. So this isn't just, you know, let's come and learn an instrument, let's learn a bit of music and stuff. There's more to it than that as well, isn't there?
There is. There's a lot more to that. And especially that for us is probably one of the things the schools really want. The schools want to see them get qualifications and want to see them go. But it's also a way for them to, like, focus. You know, if they're just in there learning and practicing, then they're not really going to do it. But we see now that accreditation we're looking at isn't really ready yet. We're still working on it, but we're hoping that the London College of Music is going to accept it. And I know you had Georgina and the dancers on earlier on. So we're hopefully looking at when the pupils get to like grade 6 and grade 8, they can be getting UCAS points for university. So we could be sitting with P7 pupils having points for university going forward. And I think for everybody, that's going to be an easy sell. You know, if you're having pupils, especially for schools, but parents as well.
Completely. I mean, I think that's fantastic, because one of the things that you mentioned at the start was about, you know, the perception that people might have. You're completely blowing this out of the water, aren't you? Because this whole idea that even at that early age, that you're building part of their future, or at least helping them build for the future, really flies in the face of popular opinion in regards to B-flat flute and flute bands in general.
It is, you know, and it's trying to get it away from them. Yes, the marching bands is something that they do, but the thing I'm trying to install in the pupils is that you're a musician. Mm. Now, when we go to the schools, you're up there with somebody playing piano, guitar. You have to treat it like that. No, you're not just somebody in a band. No, you're a musician. So when you go on and we're teaching you, you need to do the skills that musicians do. And that's like, my sort of teaching's kind of different from others as well. I will take full classes. No, I will take 30 pupils at once. So I have to conduct it like an orchestra.
And how do you find the respondent to the music thing? Because I think it's really, it's great that you are giving the emphasis on learning some of the musical theory aspect, because there's an interesting statistic there that said 20% of young people learn how to read music and 70% of adults wish they had. You know, so you are really, you know, starting the impact on those kind of numbers. But what's the response like to learn how to read music theory? Because it's not really seen as cool these days, you know, in terms of like, oh, I'm learning how to read music theory. Do you know what I mean?
And it's hard work. That's what we find. But if we can get them through it, no, and that's the tunes we teach. We sort of teach them like slow tunes to start off with. That's sort of better played. The slower you play it, the better it sounds, because that will give them a chance to do it. So we try to keep it going like that, and we do little games and stuff.
It sounds like you've went from strength to strength, from initial scepticism to being an integral part of the education of some of the schools that you're involved with. I think it's absolutely fantastic. I wish there had been something like this whenever I was growing up, and you know, I'd have got that musical grounding straight off. We're about to hear another performance from the two young lads. What are we about to hear now?
We're going to hear The Great Escape now. And again, this is what we hope will be accepted as a grade 2 tune for the flute accreditation.
Brilliant. So folks, sit back, relax, and enjoy the performance from two of the young lads who are involved in this programme with North Wales Cultural Partnership. Thanks for watching. We'll see you all next time.